Previous panelists have spoken about the reserve of oil exploration and production. We will talk about a completely different subject. It's trading oil online, that is accessing the markets. Also, there has been a mention about the amount or the abundance of oil. As it's well known to everybody now, there is crude oil, which is the natural oil, and there is shale oil, which is synthetic. Some figures were mentioned about the price of extraction of oil. I have to agree with you, Ramzi. It's around 27 to 30, 38.
Operational.
And while crude oil is, the cost of extraction is about $9 to $14, obviously it's almost half the cost of shale oil. If we look at both assets, we'll see that extracting crude oil is less damaging to the environment, it's less costly, but it has an effect on the currencies that are attributed to trading or exploration of oil. I'll come to that slide in a minute. We mention here that shale oil is synthetic. It's more costly and it takes more effort to extract it. But we noticed that since shale oil has been on the play since 2010, crude oil prices have come down. The question is it the culprit behind it, or is it, as Dr. Khomeini mentioned, maybe it's due to geopolitical reasons? Squeezing Russia and other countries, perhaps. Just let's do a quick comparison here. You will see that from 2010, crude oil prices rallied slightly for a few months, and then it was a decline, continuous decline, until we reached almost $26, $27 recently.
And the monthly chart was monthly.
You'll have to ask Anesta.
No.
Don't ask me difficult questions, okay? It is the candlestick chart. It would be a monthly chart, yeah. The purpose is to give you an indication of where the trend is. So it hovered around for a couple of years, 18 months or so. And then, as you see, as shale oil became more used and more abundant, crude oil prices were affected. Now, that coincided with the some political squeeze, if you like, or economic squeeze on OPEC and on Russia and Iran, and maybe combined together, they pushed down the prices from around $115 to $26, which is a hefty 85%. It's something to observe. Whether the reason is shale oil or not, it's something to observe. Here's a slide that shows the extraction or the exploration process of synthetic against, well, of synthetic oil, shale oil, the manufacturing, the exploration process in the States and in Canada. I leave it to you to read it. There is no need to go through fracturing, retorting, product recovery. The end use purpose is what matters. As I said, we will focus on in our presentation here on a completely different aspect, which is trading. We're not talking about physical, we're not talking about the cost of oil, we're not talking about the wealth fund that will benefit of the proceeds from oil. We're talking about oil as a commodity, as an asset class on the exchanges. So to start with a fact, crude oil, at least in the foreseeable future, will never be zero. It's a commodity. It can go down to $20, $15, but will never go to zero. Until we reach a time where it will not be used anymore in, as an energy source or for cars or for whatever factors or whatsoever. How is it traded? I don't know if any of you here, apart from the usual culprits who are in the business, but any of the students have had an exposure to trading oil contracts. Oil is traded on future exchanges, mainly the NYMEX and ICE, the Continental Exchange, for Brent. WTI is mainly traded on NYMEX, which is the oil traded in the USA, and Brent and oil in Europe, Brent oil in Europe. The volume of trading is considerable. I think there is a slide about the amounts and the volumes over there. Oil futures traded very transparently and very liquid on the exchanges, and one contract, to simplify it for those who don't know, one contract of oil traded represents 1,000 barrels. So if you buy or sell one contract of oil and oil goes down, goes up from 26 to 27, you make a $1,000 profit. I think this shows, and the slide after shows us something from Bloomberg, that WTI for the April delivery contract traded 273,000 contracts per day on the 4th of March. That's less than what Brent was traded, which is 336,000 on the 4th of March for the April delivery. I'm not going to go into details about the deliveries, but futures trade for future month, for future deliveries. So it can be April or July or anything. This is not significant here. And the volumes mentioned before, at aggregate volume 273 and 336 are mentioned there. Now this is the part that's interesting. How do you trade oil? How do you access oil? You need a mechanism or a means to reach the markets so that you can acquire that contract. And you would usually contact your brokerage firm or broker or bank if it's a private banking operation and ask them to buy for you a contract of oil. There are a few asset classes that are traded in all these aspects or ways. One of them is oil. You can trade oil in futures. You can trade oil in CFDs, which is contracts for difference. This is a contract that was created about 10 years ago in the UK to replace futures. It has more flexibility. And over the counter, which is one-to-one negotiation, you can hedge your oil trading as some oil companies do. Oil companies, if they have an inventory in a rising market and they think that within the next 3 to 6 months oil might come down, what do? Do they keep their inventory if they cannot sell it? They go to the exchanges and try to sell or offload part of their inventory in the futures markets so that if the market comes down, they would have realized the profit. If the market keeps on going up, then they would have offloaded some of their inventory and realized the price that they thought is adequate for their budget. Options, obviously, is a derivative that is used to protect the underlying assets. Not so many people would resort to utilizing options as a hedging tool, but some people might resort to options as a trading tool because the exposure can be limited if an option is bought rather than being sold. Okay, why do we trade online? Why do we trade online? Not everybody has accessibility to the markets, to the physical market, I mean. And what entices us to trade the oil online is basically a combination of the economic turmoil. So people might see an opportunity when there is an economic turmoil to go in the markets and try to lock in a profit, whether buying or selling oil, on the back of the information that's coming in the market, markets imbalances that relates to the demand and supply, and the volatility of assets. People, as I recall, Habib showed us a graph which was very interesting. People tend to follow the crowd. And his graph is very true. People first see a trend developing, they don't believe it. Then it rallies further and they say, we might have missed an opportunity. And then the market rallies further and they say, wow, that was an uptrend that we missed. And then travels further, and they decide to go in. You called it, I think Habib called it in euphoria, I think. That's when the market turns down. So that's the poor man theory, by the way, that's another name. The poor man follows the trend and he enters at the absolute wrong timing. And that's when the market starts turning down. So people see the volatility in the market. Some jump in at the right time and ride the trend and actually produce a profit, materialize a profit. And some come in late and they realize a loss, unfortunately. The online trading is very popular because it's easy, it's accessible 24 hours as long as the exchanges or the OTC markets are open. There is deep liquidity because of the enormous number of counterparties who are providing liquidity in this commodity. There is transparency. We all are consumers. If you want to buy or sell something, you would like to know what's the real price with no ambiguity. So there is very much transparency. And in some conditions, and this is very much applicable to Lebanon now, if there is a stagnant economy and people are not producing revenues, they go to the markets thinking that's a good opportunity to produce or trade. I can see some smiles, or lose some money while there is nothing else to do. So it is an opportunity to basically tackle the markets. If tackled properly, you'll make money. I would like to stress just very quickly that lots of corporate clients would trade oil as a hedging tool against their physical production. Finally, the option table here shows that option can be traded and the strike prices are various, as well as the maturity dates. So we can go almost on every month on the maturity. The part that relates to currencies is the part that is interesting. Not everybody understands oil, and not everybody feels comfortable with oil. But some people who are engaged in currency trading might find that oil gives them a reading, an advanced reading of where the currency could go. And this is why we showed you here three boxes with three groups of currencies. If oil is positive, that means if it's rallying, you would see that the dollar, the US dollar, would rally against the euro, the Japanese yen, Nigerian naira, and the Swiss franc. In countries where the dollar to the other currency is pegged, it's fixed, like the Lebanese pound or the Saudi riyal, the effect is neutral, because if the dollar goes up or down, it's a fixed rate. When oil prices go up, on certain number of currencies, which we call commodity currencies, the dollar will go down. You would see that the Canadian dollar would strengthen, sterling would strengthen, which is not mentioned here, Australian dollar and Russian ruble. So some traders might take an indication on the currency's direction from the price of oil, and sometimes vice versa. But it's initially starting point to trade is the oil for these currencies. This is just basically a box here. Brokerage firms offers to the clients to access the markets.